Good afternoon, everyone. Congratulations, you've made it to the final session of today. Happy hour is close, but first, we are going to talk about Oculi. So Oculi is an awesome new technology that's been developed by Google, which allows for the automated analysis of creative. And from that analysis, what we can do is we can then use it to optimize and maximize the performance of our digital ad campaigns. My name is Cory. I'm the head of creative at Jellyfish. I'm going to be joined today by Oli, solutions engineer at Google, and James, a data scientist at Jellyfish. So I certainly don't want to insult anyone's intelligence, but I think, you know, we're going to say the word creative probably 1,000 times today in this presentation. So I want to get us on the same page. I want to make sure that we're speaking the same language. So what is a creative? I think according to this slide, it says they are visual materials used to generate leads and sell advertising for marketing. But to me, really, all it is an advertising format, a creative asset. It could be a social animation. It could be a video on YouTube. It could be a display ad, a static ad, an HTML display ad. Any of these things, any of these creative assets, we're going to be referring to them as creatives. And what is creative analysis? Well, basically, it's when we start comparing one or more of these creatives and comparing their performance based off their specific characteristics. One example that you've probably come across already in your time in this field is, do lifestyle creatives perform better than product creatives? This is just one example, but you can see the visual difference between the two approaches. Now, why would we want to do this? I think it's fairly obvious. The goal is we want to maximize our ROI. You know, we want to ensure that we're maximizing all of those performance metrics that we're using to judge the success or failure of our digital ad campaigns. We invest a lot of money in these campaigns, and we want to make sure that they're paying off for us and our clients. Now, the good news is there's a lot of people out there that understand this. I have a couple quotes. This one here from the global head of programmatic at Coca-Cola says that to get the real value out of programmatic, we have to get the creative right. We have to use relevant messaging. Without the right messaging, programmatic buying will not reach its fullest potential. Another quote I like, director of digital marketing at Netflix, great creative can overcome a poor media plan, but the opposite probably isn't true, and those that marry the two stand to gain a huge advantage in the minds and wallets of consumers. And I could not agree more, but you know, you might think I'm a little biased. The good news is that, you know, I think a lot of you probably agree, but the bad news is that there's a lot of folks out there in our industry that don't understand this, because unlike TV or print, where creative will oftentimes be the very first step in the process, when it comes to digital, creative is often an afterthought. It's like, hey, we have a great media plan, just throw whatever the creative team has created and put it up there. The problem is you're really cutting off any potential to really fully realize the true potential of the campaign. Now, there's a lot of reasons for this, and you see some of them up here on this slide, but I look at them as more excuses than anything else, because they're so easy to overcome. All of these things lead to bad advertising, which does not put the consumer first, and it's also bad for our industry. Think about all the negativity around our industry, whether it's widespread distaste and distrust for advertising, ad blockers, all that kind of stuff. If creative was good and actually was putting the consumer first at all times, we probably wouldn't be where we are today, in my opinion. And what all of this is pointing to is that the quality of the creative really does matter. It's what people want. You know, they want relevant advertising that's important to them, that's giving them something of value and that's not offensive to them in some way. And if we give that to them, it actually performs better. We have the metrics, we have the numbers to back it up. High quality creative can drive 200 to 400% increase in campaign response rate, and creative variables account for more than half of the total sales impact of a campaign. And this can be broken out a little bit more, this stat. This is a Nielsen study. It shows all of the different advertising elements that can contribute to sales. And by far, creative is the most significant, you know, with almost 50% of the changes in a brand sales over time being attributed to the creative rather than these other factors like targeting and reach and context, et cetera, all these other areas that we've talked a lot about today. And even though this is true, the fact still remains that as of today, currently, on average, about 90% of the media spend, of the spend is going to the media, and only 10% of the spend is going towards the development of high-quality creative. But the impact, the results of the campaign campaigns are almost reversed, with 70% of a campaign success being attributed to the quality of the creative itself rather than the media plan. So what this really means is that we can have the perfect media plan. We can have precise targeting. We can know that we're putting an ad in front of the right person at the right time, and we can still fail to realize the full potential of our advertising campaigns if the creative sucks and it's not resonating with that target audience. Now, it's important for you to understand that I'm not suggesting that we suddenly shift 70% of our budget over to creative, although that would make me happy personally, of course, but it's more of a shift in mindset. We need to start thinking a lot more about creative, considering it on a deeper level, and giving it the proper attention that it deserves, because it really does have the biggest impact on the success or failure of our campaigns. So how do we make sure that we're developing high quality creative? It starts with data insights. So there are many potential insights that would be helpful to a creative person like myself when we're starting off our brainstorming and our ideation. There's just a few here on this slide, and I know you can't see one of them because of the color, but it's not important. It's just things like, you know, knowing when to show the brand logo, or knowing what types of imagery are going to resonate with our target audience. Knowing that if we show a certain person with a certain facial expression, that it's probably gonna increase performance. But all of these things, all of these potential insights, if we were actually going to work to understand them and gather them in today's landscape, we would have to manually tag all of these creatives. It would have to be done by a single person. It would have to be done, again, manually, and it would have to be done up front prior to setting up any of the campaigns. And that can be pretty unwieldy when you consider all of the different variations and that we might possibly want to test. So as an example of this, let's start. There's like two main components, I think, from a creative perspective, almost any advertising format, no matter what it is. You've got text, you've got copy, and you've got imagery. So let's start with text. Think about all the words in the English language, all the different combinations of those words that we can use to write our headlines, write our subheadlines, write our CTA copy. It would almost be impossible, you know, to manually tag all the headlines that we might want to test, all of the different CTAs that we might want to test. We just don't have the time or the resources for it. But it's necessary because, as you know, in the digital space, we have limited space. We don't have the luxury of telling a long-winded story. We have to be very selective with our words. We have to be very concise. No one is interested in engaging with something like on the left. It's going to turn people off. We have to be, again, concise and clean if we have any chance at all of reaching that consumer. But identifying the perfect words and actually knowing which few words we should be using to maximize performance, that's the challenge. And even when we've written the perfect copy and we've taken the perfect approach with our words, oftentimes they're going to be ignored anyway. People are not consuming content to look at ads. You know, no one cares about ads. Maybe some people in this room don't even care about ads that much. I don't know. But I definitely know that the average person on the street thinks they don't like advertising. And I don't discount their sincerity. But there are plenty of industry studies that indicate that when an advertisement is actually relevant and non-disruptive and respectful, they're much more open to that ad. But my point here is that oftentimes by default, people have on blinders and they're not going to look at an ad and they're certainly not going to read a bunch of copy. So we have to take advantage of imagery. Our selection of imagery becomes all the more important because that's the one element that we stand a chance to draw attention with. And you may say, big deal. Well, it's a huge deal because, as I just said, most ads are ignored. So just getting someone's eyes on the ad in a way where they're not feeling negative and they're receptive to what our offering is a huge first step before we can ever even hope to get a click or a conversion. So the image is very important. So the point here is if we don't need to tell a long-winded story, don't, you know, use images to get our point across. We can actually accomplish a great deal of storytelling through images if we understand which characteristics are going to resonate with our target audience and actually drive performance. And that's where Oculi is going to come in. You're going to learn about this in just a second. It all comes down to what resonates with a particular audience. With some audiences, we might want to get more conceptual, but with other audiences, they may not understand this type of approach. With other audiences, we may want to, you know, try to talk in metaphor a little bit more, you know, in order to pique their interest, their curiosity, get their brain working. But with other audiences, they just might not get it. With other audiences still, we might want to try to establish more of an emotional connection to get across a certain feeling or help us tell a multi-layered story that we necessarily can't get across as easily when we're writing our copy. And then finally, there's going to be other times when we actually want to focus on the audience themselves. You know, people like to see themselves in advertising. They like to envision that they're living this better life or that they're getting this benefit that the product is offering. So we can do that with images that are really focused on emotions, environments, and even the clothing that someone is wearing can actually determine whether an ad is going to resonate with someone or not. Now, picture this for a second. That's a lot of stuff. That's a lot of characteristics there that we need to keep track of, that we need to tag, that we need to evaluate. It's a lot of work. You know, they say, the cliche goes, that a picture is worth 1,000 words. And I certainly wouldn't want to be the person that has to manually tag those 1,000 words in order to draw some insights from our advertising campaigns. And I think that's the biggest challenge right now, is how do we gain, and I just gave you a few just now. That's just a few just off the top, you know, for images. But imagine how much further we could go with this and what we could learn from our creative executions if we had the time and resources. First, it can be very expensive, you know, so there could potentially be multiple teams involved. Resources cost a lot of money. Secondly, it's a very manual process right now. So, you know, analysis has to be done, again, like I said earlier, by a person, and they have to do it one at a time. And then finally, it's very rigid. So the tests would have to be set up ahead of time. There's not a lot of flexibility for analysis after the fact. So what if there was a technology where you didn't have to do any of this stuff? What if there's a technology that, you know, alleviated all of these issues for us and allowed us to retroactively evaluate every creative that we've ever done and draw these insights, some of these insights that I just described? That's where Oculi comes in, and that's why I'm so excited, and I'm very happy now to pass this over.
Thanks, Cory. Hi, I'm Oli. I am a solutions engineer here at Google. So on my day-to-day, I work with partners and agencies to help them build engineering solutions that can help them achieve their business objectives. So for the last few months, we've been hearing that analyzing creatives has been top of mind for a lot of these partners. So we are like, we hear you for all of the reasons that Cory mentioned, and we want to be able to help you to solve that problem. Project Oculi was that attempt to help partners analyze their creatives and do so in a way that is actually scalable. So what exactly is Project Oculi? In one single sentence, it's a service that enables creative content analysis using machine learning and cloud technology, and doing so at massive scale. Now, I know what you just thought about that. You probably thought that was a whole bunch of buzzwords put into one sentence so that it can be packaged and marketed. But to be honest, let's try and parse that a little bit. Let's try and understand what does it really mean, each and every component of this. So beginning with creative content analysis, what does it really mean to analyze a creative content? So let's look at this Captain Morgan image. So imagine you're on the creative team that's executing a campaign for Captain Morgan. What are the potential things that you would look out for? So you might be curious if the messaging works. Does Live Like a Captain work? You may be curious about, does this happy guy posing as Captain Morgan work? You might also be curious about the color scheme. Does the color, the different shades of red, actually conform to the brand that you're trying to convey? And there is a public Google technology that can actually help you get this and get this quickly and reliably. So using that same piece of technology, you can go one step further. So essentially, you're looking at a Reebok ad. So at this ad, you may be curious, do I, as somebody on the creative team, that do I include the logo on the top left or do I do it on the top right? How big should it be? So that is something that the technology can piece out. Also, you may be curious about what are the other things with this image that this actually signals. So for example, if I saw this ad and if this was about Reebok shoes, I personally wouldn't buy it, but that's because I hate getting dirty. So maybe you'd want to keep that in mind. So you want to be able to fetch if this actually represents things like mud. You also want to be able to understand if 15% off, if like discounts like that work with a certain particular type of audience. So the technology actually allows you to get these sort of insights right out of the box. Let's look at one final creative, which is this Old Spice ad. Now, for any advertiser, brand safety is clearly on top of their agenda, as you want to understand if this is going to be a problematic ad. The technology that I've been talking about can actually help you understand if this really could be a problem. So if you can see here, this image is not necessary. I mean, it's unlikely to be an adult image, but it is definitely a racy image. So things like that. So what is this cool piece of Google technology that I have been talking about? So there are essentially two pieces here, which is the Vision API, which is essentially for understanding images. And then you have the Video Intelligence API, which is to understand videos. So to actually understand what sort of capabilities can come out of it, let's look at an actual problem that Jellyfish had with their advertiser, which is Walden University. So they wanted to basically see if including a model with a happy face versus a model with a neutral face work. So the Google piece of technology, that is the Vision API, is actually available online for anyone to try. So let's try to look at what would happen if you're at an agency and you have all these different creatives. You probably have 30,000 of them for one particular account. How would you do that? So the way we've done this is you would take all of this and you would extract all of the data that we were just talking about, and you would put them neatly into tables. So these are just to sample, just to show you the tabular format, but obviously the wealth of data that you get from the API is much, much more massive. So as you can see, for example, the logos table for the Captain Morgan creative, you can actually tell that the logo is in top left. For the Old Spice, it's on top right. And the analysis that you can do on top of this is truly incredible. So like we said, let's try and understand how we've actually done this. So we basically take all our creatives, which are stored in the Campaign Manager ad server. And then we basically want an output like the tabular format that we just showed, which would be put into this data warehouse. But to get to that data warehouse, we would need to process it through the Vision API. But now is the interesting part. It's how we have actually made this doable in a small amount of time and made sure that this is reliable is through the use of cloud components, which may seem like a whole bunch of Greek, but to be honest, this is just you can think of them as an army of computers trying to do this simultaneously all at once so that you can have your data in no time. As a result of this analysis, we also provide an online folder, if you will, of all your creative assets, whether it's video, it's images, and use that as a way to validate the analysis that you've done. Finally, if you want to see at a glance of, say, all the images that have faces, you basically take your data and you put it through a dashboarding product like Data Studio, and there you go. But so how did we actually solve for the problems that that Cory was talking about. So that's expensive manual widget. So essentially, we use the Vision API to make this less expensive and less manual. Also, we've created the pipeline, so it just does it at scale. Finally, we've gotten rid of the problem of rigidity by using the App Engine component, which is the army of computer to allow for flexible scaling. And also, if you wanted to analyze something different the next time, so instead of analyzing faces, you wanted to analyze logos, that's clearly doable with the format that we have. So often, this is all great that you have all the data, but it's not enough because you want to be able to connect the data that you have to an actual business insight. So that is where this comes in. So for a truly, so to use a Powerpuff Girls analogy, for a truly Powerpuff analysis, you have sugar, spice, and everything nice, which is the raw data from Oculi. And what you really are missing is Chemical X, which is the data analysis piece that Jellyfish has done. So now I'd like to call upon James to explain the wonderful work that they have done.
Hey everybody, I'm James. I'm a data scientist at Jellyfish. So yeah, we're the Chemical X piece, I suppose. So one of the first things I wanted to get to was how are we using this solution? And it primarily augments our comprehensive data strategy by informing our data-driven creative analysis approach. And then it helps us increase performance for our clients. As Cory mentioned, creatives account for a significant percentage of performance. So if we can be just a little bit better at it, we can offer a significant performance lift. And then to that end, it helps us quickly and efficiently discover what works. So when Google approached us to do this partnership, we wanted to figure out if there was any meaningful and significant data that was coming out of the Vision API. So we set up a series of tests using the adjusted viewable click-through rate as our performance metric, which is essentially just clicks over total viewable impressions. Then we split our creatives into two groups, having and not having a specific feature. And then finally used a two-sample t-test for significance testing. So with that said, our first hypothesis was that creatives with happy facial expressions have historically performed better than creatives with faces that don't have a happy expression. We had 184 creatives with happy facial expressions and 16 with faces without happy expressions. And then the results of our tests were that creatives with happy faces have historically performed 2 times better than creatives without happy faces. For our second hypothesis, we wanted to measure the effectiveness of call to action buttons. To do this, we had to do a bit of feature engineering on top of the Vision API, which is one of the cool things of the Google partnership is that we can build on each other's work. So I used the OpenCV computer vision library to find the locations of all of the buttons in all of our creatives with something like 90% accuracy. And then once we had the locations of the buttons, we could cross-reference it with the Vision API data to figure out the context of the call to action, what words were inside the button or outside. We can do a ton of stuff with that. So our second hypothesis was that using the call to action follow your why typically had lower performance than using other text. And there were 172 creatives with other text and 16 with follow your why. And when other text was used, the performance was 2 times better than using follow your why. So these are just some things that we can look at. There's tons of features that you saw with the Vision API. We can then augment those features, building meta features on top of it, looking at things like where the call to action buttons are, what the contrast is with the color of the button and the background, relative size, etc. There's tons of stuff we can do with that. So our next steps, and the first thing we've started working on is building a self-serve analytics dashboard. So basically this would be a client-facing dashboard that would have all of their creatives and all of the features that are available in different tabular and graphical views so that they can get a sense of what the feature mix is of their portfolio. And then we can use this to inform further hypothesis-driven analysis based on historical performance. And finally, we're exploring building a machine learning model to predict performance based on feature mix. So we're really excited about this tool, and it's going to offer us just tons of new insights, and it's going to be really great for informing our creative development process. So with that said, I'm going to give it back to Cory to talk about the creative perspective of using a tool like this.
Yeah, thanks. So it's been awesome. And I am also very excited about the future potential of this. Keep in mind, it's just in its infancy right now, you know, so that's why we're so excited to partner with new folks and see what we can really do with it. What I'm really excited about at this moment is that it doesn't cause any sort of disruption to what we're doing already. It actually augments and enhances the approach that we already take. What you see up here on this slide isn't specific to Oculi. This is the approach that Jellyfish takes to developing best-in-class performance-based advertising day in and day out. We take a very strategic approach. It starts with data always. So it could be first-party data, third-party data, previous campaign learnings, competitor analysis, consumer surveys, et cetera. But now we have Oculi data now to introduce in that phase as well. So when we're in our ideation, we now can consider the learnings that we've extracted using Oculi. We always also follow best practices that are also based on data. So my team has developed a set of proprietary best practices that are based on over 10 years of exhausted A/B testing across all of our verticals. The best practices are sound. They work great. We use them day in and day out again for our clients to drive and maximize performance, but it took a long time and a lot of effort to get there. Now, we have Oculi that we can introduce into that in order to iterate on these best practices, make sure that they're actually true and based on data, and it's not just like an opinion. And we can also develop new best practices as we learn new things. Third, we always try to personalize the ad experience whenever possible. This is key. You know, this is kind of like right ad, right user, right time. It's kind of an industry cliche at this point. We all know it, but it really is true. It really is what we're after, and it's what drives maximum performance for us. This is where we're frequently using dynamic creative technology to deliver personalized and unique ad experience to individual consumers. Now, we can use Oculi to test specific creative assets out with certain audiences, find out what resonates with those audiences the most, so that we can understand how to better personalize our dynamic creative campaigns in the future. And then third, we always want to measure in real time. We don't want to wait 1 month, 3 months, 6 months to determine whether what we did was a success or a failure. We want to iterate in real time. And again, Oculi allows us to do that. We can monitor campaign performance day over day. We can pull new reports, extract new learnings, and then respond to them in real time. So it's pretty exciting to me as a creative person because we can ensure that we're doing the best possible job for our clients. So in summary, these are some of the specific things that we're now able to work with James on. At Jellyfish, we can identify specific creative characteristics and we can measure their impact on performance, both negatively and positively, and we can gain a lot from that exercise. Second, and this kind of goes back to what I just said, we can establish new best practices specific to certain clients, specific to certain verticals, and even best practices that are kind of across the board type of approaches. I just also talked about the ability to fine tune our approach to A/B testing, make it a lot more efficient, and also allow us to iterate and optimize in real time rather than waiting months to make any sort of changes that are going to move the needle. And then these final two bullet points right here are more from a creative perspective, but I feel like this is always what my intent is when I'm working on any sort of advertising campaign, is I want to communicate more effectively with the target audience. I want to establish an emotional connection with my target audience because I know if I do that successfully, I'm going to raise awareness, favorability, recall, and intent, and all of that is achieved as we can go back and look at those numbers that I led off today's presentation with. All of that is happening at the creative level. You know, so it's important to understand that. And that's why it's so significant. So if you're interested in learning more about this, if you want to get your feet wet, I would encourage you to talk to us, probably these two, a little bit more than me, if you have any in-depth technical questions. I just like to take advantage of all their hard work, but they're the ones that can get in the weeds. But what you should know is that we have the tools, the knowledge, the expertise. We have a very collaborative approach at Jellyfish. We want to work with you. We want to help you get a grasp on this so that you can take full advantage of it, so that you can really, you know, unleash the full potential of your digital marketing campaigns using this Oculi-powered analysis to automate your creative analysis.